Hi, everybody. Really appreciate all of your support and appreciate you guys all coming out tonight. So I guess for me, I'm a serial entrepreneur. I started my first company in the early days of the internet, and over the course of my career, built several businesses. First in kind of early internet infrastructure, web hosting, after that, cloud software, and more recently as a co-founder of Fuze, which is a collaboration and communications business.
That is extremely modest.
Yeah,
those right. were kind of big deals. Maybe Blade Logic went public, was sold for a lot of money, $850 million. Fuze raised how much money?
Half a billion.
Half a billion, worth a billion plus. So he's being quite modest here. So you had lots of choices of what to do next. Why'd you pick Algorand?
Well, I don't know. You introduced me. No. I became interested in sort of the blockchain and crypto space, I guess, early 2017, something like that. Jamie knew it was something that interested me. He introduced me to Silvio. And what I found really exciting, which I still find today, is that really more than any other time since the early days of the internet, I felt there were really similar dynamics where there were sort of moving kind of social changes going on, and there was such interesting technology, so much opportunity. And after meeting Silvio, it was I became really fascinated by his approach, for sure. And so I think more than anything else to me, you know, what I observed in kind of the early days of the internet was it wasn't the first companies out of the gates that did really well. It was the people who came a little bit later, the Googles and Amazons, and that really could bring great technology with business people that knew how to execute. And to me, it felt like there was a real opportunity to do something similar in this space. So I think that's
perfect. Awesome. Okay, so why, talk a little bit about blockchains and why you think it matters, and like, why is it worth these people spending their time on it?
So the question I get asked like almost all the time, like every day, is like, why do blockchains matter? Why does decentralization matter? Like, I don't get it. And sort of the way we've really think about it is like in a few different discrete ways. I think first, if you think about what the internet really did over a period of time, it created a world where information flows freely, more or less. But in the financial world, money does not. And I think the other thing that's really kind of a trend that's picking up a lot of steam right now that even wasn't 6 months ago is that if you look at just sort of the concentration of power that comes from a relatively small number of institutions, I think people are really starting to question whether that's the right thing, whether it's Google or Facebook. I don't know if you guys saw last week's Time Magazine's cover of Facebook and like if we really want them stewarding our personal data. But also, if you look at banks, 20 years ago, there were 40 big banks in the US. Today, there are four. And those four banks command double the amount of money than the 40 banks did 20 years ago. So there's a lot of shifting, a lot of concentration. And I think for people who have just sort of lived their lives over a period of time, I think it's really easy to just sort of not notice that stuff. I think for younger people, for sure, it's a lot easier to notice that there are problems out there. And so I think to me, that's why, ultimately those are problems that blockchain can solve, that decentralization can solve, and that ultimately, like from our perspective, the idea of a borderless system is something that's really important. And then when you couple that with the fact that over 2 billion of the world's people have no access to modern financial services, we think there's an enormous opportunity not only to make money, but to really do do social good in that arena. And just the last point I'll leave all of you guys with on this piece is that 6% of all of the world's GDP, every dollar that every person earns everywhere, slides out the back door in the form of transaction fees and other fees, and just due to friction in the system. And we think that that's an enormous opportunity to improve efficiency by orders of magnitude.
Thanks,
that was.
So, oops, slightly earlier.
That's my picture.
You look great.
Yeah.
You haven't aged a bit.
I haven't aged since that picture was taken like 2 months ago.
So I think the tagline is now the borderless economy. So you guys are using the word borderless a lot. Help us understand what you mean.
Well, I think borderless kind of relates back, in our opinion, to decentralization. And we spent a lot of time really thinking about like what the core of that was and what it meant. And one of the ways that I think you can define it is if you look at what GDP is in a traditional economy, the biggest elements are real estate and labor. And so when you think about a borderless economy and decentralization, we don't have labor, we don't have land. So what do we have? And I think for us, we really have spent time thinking about like, the inherent benefits of blockchain and kind of the crypto space. And you know, really, I think it comes down to a few different things. One, you know, when you shift to a borderless concept, capital formation changes. Now you can raise money from many more people in many different places. It's also a much better outcome from the people that are investing, because now people, we even saw this in our own fundraise, people that we would never talk to likely in a traditional setting were able to invest and participate in a project like this. We were able to broaden our horizons and have participants from all over the world. So I think that's really interesting. The second is, you know, tokenization really at some fundamental level, I think provides a way to change the liquidity properties of different kinds of assets. And Jamie mentioned this in his opening talk, but whether it's art or real estate or any form of sort of asset that might be illiquid or semi-liquid, now you can completely change the properties and the ways that, that those element or items can transact. And then lastly,
including startup companies, including venture capital firms, like everything.
Yeah, for sure. Lots of stuff. And I think the last thing is really there. It also gives rise to completely new concepts or relatively new concepts like digital scarcity. We were meeting with a partner the other day and learned that, you know, Disney has issued, I believe, 50 non-fungible tokens that represent the Death Star. So if in your game you want to stream a virtual version of the Death Star, you buy one of these tokens, you plug it in, and it unlocks you being able to stream it off their site. Those are the kinds of things that we see coming
along.
You said
non-fungible. Not everybody might know what that
is. Oh, unique. Sorry, unique tokens. That's by what I mean by digital scarcity, by the way, is the ability to represent a unique item. And I think blockchains allow for that. In a
so like a signed piece of art, like here's number 40 out of 50.
Yeah, exactly. And I just want like last point sort of on this. The other thing that we really believe strongly in, I think whenever there's a new technology that comes out or sort of a new movement, people get really excited. And that over-exuberance we see, I think we saw it at the end of 2017 in the crypto space. We saw it in 2000 in the internet space. It's sort of just a part of the cycle. At the same time, I think one of the things that we think is for sure true is that it's not like traditional economies are going to disappear. And it's also like not like crypto economies are going to disappear. One of the things that we think is incredibly important is having connectivity back to traditional economies, connectivity to other crypto economies. And so in terms of borderless economy, we ourselves see ourselves as a participant in a shifting economic world. But we also realize that you have to create real ways for people to transact with each other and you know make that a very seamless process for them. And that's something we're definitely focused on.
So one of the things I've been surprised by is how much time we spend at the board talking about the economy you guys are going to create and management of that economy. Why is that important for what you're doing?
We see there's sort of three pillars that you need to build a successful ecosystem. So one is great foundational tech. Silvio is much more qualified than I am to talk about that, and he will in a minute. The second is economic management, and really thinking about not just how you kind of copy things that centralized, you know, central banks and governments have done, but how you look at ways to create decentralized constructs that help create economic stability. And a lot of, you know, the world and sort of crypto has shifted from totally unstabilized currencies like Bitcoin and Ethereum and others to stable coins. You know, we think those swings are also a little bit too far, and that you need to think about, you know, relative stability and give people ways to come from their own fiat currencies into your economy. And then lastly, on the tech side, we just think it's too hard to, you know, figure out blockchain. There's 200,000 developers in the world that are blockchain developers, and there's 29.8 million that are not. So I think we haven't really hit the starting line yet. And you know, the way that we get people excited and make it easy for them is really thinking more like Stripe or Twilio than having everyone have to learn about all the systems. We want to make it really easy for everyone. And so, you know, part of the reason, so it's, this is the answer to economics. It's also the answer, I think, on the dev side and other places too.
Great. What can you say about use cases that you guys are seeing, needs that you see for the blockchain and kind of people you're working with in these early days?
Look, we see a lot of different things. Just to give you guys some context, we've done meetups in more than 25 countries over the past 6 months. or so, and everyone should thank Silvio. He's been around the world like half a dozen times in that period. You know, we're engaged with, you know, more than 80 projects who are starting to build and engage with our network. And so we're seeing all kinds of interesting stuff, whether it's from, you know, gaming or finance or real estate and others. And, you know, in a little while, you'll hear from the Algo Capital guys who'll give you a little bit more of a sense into some like very specific use cases. But we're seeing it really across the board. And we think this distinction between, you know, I think there's a lot of people who tend to like zoom in on dApps as sort of a discrete thing, or financial instruments or products as another. We sort of see it as one continuum where you need to just bring the right tools to people and give them ways to use it. So,
okay, great. So we, you know, things were absolutely crazy a year ago. Bitcoin was 20,000 or something like that. It's now not. Like, what do you think? If you were an entrepreneur, is now the right time to be thinking about this market? You know, how would you be thinking about it if you were one of the folks sitting here in the audience?
Well, I was at an event recently with Albert Wenger from USV. And he said, you know, look, the tourists have left the building. I don't know if his exact quote, Nick might know it. I think the point is this, and this is something we talk about amongst ourselves frequently. This is a great time to be building applications. At the same time, I think it's good to sort of clear away people who weren't doing real work. But if, you know, if you look at the growth in dApps, you look at the growth in companies, there's a lot of work going on in this space right now. And I think it's never been a better time to get started, because I think people are really settling down, looking for high quality projects, looking for credible people and stories out there. And in the end, our view is that, you know, the market's just going to oscillate around until projects like Algorand come out and really help drive the market forward. And so not only do we want to do well, we hope you know, other people in the market who are coming out, other substantive projects do well. But we totally ignore kind of the market cap, and we're just going to proceed ahead with our plans, because we think, you know, real companies coming out, driving real economic activity and helping support great projects with great business models is what it takes.
But if you look as a venture capitalist, the companies that were born in 2002 and 2003, when there wasn't a lot of competition, like the best companies got funded, the other ones died. And the companies that were born in 2008, 2009, 2010, when it was really hard to raise money, they were remarkably successful. And so it's actually one of the best times to start a company. Resources are available. Rent is cheaper. When things turn down, it's a great time to be starting a company. So
I agree for sure. It's a great time to start. There's a lot of new tech coming out. We'd love for those of you who are starting companies, you know, come talk to us, and we hope you build it on Algorand.